And one other thing. As a consequence of having been perhaps the world's leading affluent society, if I can use that phrase, over the last almost a century now, on a continent that was blessed with an abundant supply of land, American households are, and American families, tend, and to this day, I think generally are, what one might describe by world standards as house rich, which is to say they live in their own spaces, they have a certain set of personal equipment, they tend to have homes, garages, yards. This is a society which is predominantly a suburban society with people living in detached homes. A very important point for the thinking about the economic consequences of the pandemic. So each of these elements, I would argue, of the U.S. position has actually proved to be a severe disadvantage in terms of the economic response to COVID-19. If one takes, first of all, the position of technology and finance and the world American position of the world economy, the problem here is that the technology sector, the advanced sector, produces capital goods for world markets. And the market for global capital goods has, in some respects, effectively collapsed. A canonical case here is the aircraft industry, of which there are only two major producers of civilian aircraft in the world, and they sell to global markets. Obviously, when half or more of the aircraft are sitting on the ground, of the airworthy planes are sitting on the ground, there's not going to be much of a market for new production in that sphere. In the oil industry, the United States has the peculiar position of being a high-cost producer because of the cost and expense of fracking in an industry which is governed by a world price, which is presently about half the U.S. cost of production. And so that industry is also very severely impacted. Within the U.S. economy, in the capital goods sector, commercial and retail construction is obviously not going to be a major factor going forward. Commercial office buildings are going to be very much underused because of the pandemic and because of the discovery that many people in the white collar trades can work at home. Retail spaces are going begging because of the rapid transition to digital services. So there's construction in that sector is essentially not going to be revived anytime soon. And this all, of course, will feed back eventually on the financial sector, which holds the mortgages and the debts of the corporations and the construction firms and everything else, the developers and so forth, who have been active in those sectors up to the point at which the pandemic hit. When the effects on the financial sector will be felt, as anyone's guess, mine would be effectively that it's only a matter of time. Now let's move to the second thing, which is the services sector, a sector in which practically all of the new jobs created since the last crisis in 2007-2009 have been located. This is a sector which has provided to an amazing degree the pleasures and diversions of a wealthy society. We can talk about restaurants, about bars, about coffee houses, about spas, resorts, casinos, music festivals, gyms, nail salons, tattoo parlors, massage therapists. One can go on and on. And you walk around an American city 6 months ago, you would find these activities. And also boutique shops and all kinds of things which are effectively leisure activities. And it would be fair to characterize much of higher education in that those terms as well as essentially a consumer good rather than, economists like to think, an investment good. Well, these activities animate economic life. They provide employment and incomes, but in effect, they're not essential. And in a society which is, as I described, house rich, it's possible for a very large number of people effectively to retreat into their homes and to substitute very easily against the services which they were previously being induced to go out and purchase on the market. Well, they can do that. And that is a protective measure. It's protective both in a health sense and in a financial sense, because then you cut back on your expenditures and you can spare more, you can be somehow somewhat protected against the non-contingent debts that you happen to have, mortgages, rent, utility bills, and so forth, that you expect to continue for an indefinite future. But at the same time, you're depriving everybody else of an income and of employment. And the whole system had a kind of interdependence which made it very fragile. And my argument is that in the US case, in the case of comparable economies, they effectively, it was a house of cards, and that the wind of the coronavirus blew it down. Implication of my argument is that the peculiar structure of the most advanced economies has put them, and particularly the United States, in a singularly difficult position. This argument places me at odds with both of the most prevalent strands of economic thinking, so far as I'm aware of it, in relation to COVID-19. These two strands are the traditional strands of basically the division of thought in the economics profession. I could take what I call the neoliberal or neoclassical view, which is of an economy as a self-regulating structure, which sees the pandemic as a shock, and a shock that will be reversed when the effective measures on public health are finally taken and the virus is controlled. This view, I would take it to be the view of the incumbent administration and of many forecasters who saw a deep dive to be followed by what was called a V-shaped recovery, which clearly hasn't happened, places all of the policy emphasis on getting the virus under control on a vaccine or a therapy, and after that expects the economy to follow with a fast recovery. That these will be resolved, the problems of the economy will be resolved on their own. Against that view, modestly against it, one I call the neo-Keynesian view, or the American version of Keynesianism, according to which there will be economic consequences of recession, but those can be dealt with by the infusion of cash, essentially by a policy that goes by the term of stimulus. Measures that prime the pump or kickstart the engine of renewed prosperity. I'm not opposed to measures along these lines. Cash infusions in the spring bought a certain amount of time and deferred a certain amount of social pressure that would otherwise have occurred. But in my view, they are not and they cannot be sufficient because of the issues just raised. And that the only one of the three that they actually deal with, and so long as the cash infusions continue, is the problem of debt. In other words, they create a privileged class of landlords and debt holders who get paid, while everybody else is sitting at home hoping to be called back to jobs that, in fact, will have a very, very great difficulty being revived. Because in the case of advanced markets, the world capital markets are not under, world markets for capital goods are not under the control of public authority. And in the case of the services, essentially my job depends upon you having your job and your job depends upon me having mine. And this is an intricate dance, which is unlikely to resume anytime soon on the same terms that occurred before the pandemic. So for these reasons, I would argue the pandemic has had a very peculiar effect of creating particularly severe problems and intractable conditions in the most advanced globalized economies. Whereas if one takes the case of our neighbors and friends in Asia, what one finds is, irrespective of their ideological differences, these economies are still centered largely on the manufacture of consumer goods, which is to say they supply to their own markets and to the world as a whole. And these industries are amenable to support by expansion of domestic demand, so that they are not entirely or largely dependent upon the global market. That's the first thing. The second thing I would argue, and this is a rather maybe a more difficult point, is that in the Asian economies, the services trades, which are also very numerous, supply a lot of employment, are to a larger degree essential to the life of the community than they are in the more advanced, than the richer countries, and the countries that are still somewhat richer They are more essential to the fabric of life. If you live in an apartment in a confined space, chances are you're spending more of your time as a matter basically of living necessity out in the community, out on the street, out in the shops, out in the restaurants, and in other kinds of service providing centers. So I would argue that not only is the manufacturing sector more resilient, so too is the services sector in the Asian setting.
The World Knowledge Forum.